So before we move on, are there any questions about the statement of Eddie Stone? I know that was a little bit fast. Hopefully you'll see more of it on Monday. Probably Simon will prove this, at least in the case, the chromatic number three case. So the proof is, it's not so simple. It's not as complicated as van der Verden maybe, but it's takes a little bit of doing. No? Okay. So let's ask some questions about bipartite graphs. So a bipartite graph is just one which you can divide into two parts. So bipartite graph has chromatic number at most two. So all of the edges lie between the two parts. So H is bipartite if and only if chromatic number of H is at most two, if and only if there exists a bipartition of the vertex set such that for all edges of H X is in A and Y is in B, or vice versa. Okay. So you can find a partition into two parts such that all of the edges go between. Okay. That's the same as having chromatic number two. I'll leave that there for now. There we go. Okay, so EG the graph C4 is bipartite. Because what? Partition the vertices like this. Yep. You're saying they should be disjoint? A and B?
Yes. X and Y.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's not an edge. Yeah. Yeah. And similarly, if X and Y are both in B. Yeah. So, no edges here, and no edges here. So similarly, C2K is bipartite for all K. C2K plus 1 is not bipartite. Okay. So even cycles are bipartite, because you can color red, blue, red, blue, red, blue, and it matches up at the end. But with an odd cycle, you'll have to have two of the same color. Okay. Okay, so a question. What is the extremal number of C4? So we know, well, we haven't proved, but it follows from Eddie Stone that you only need little o n squared. So you need only a tiny fraction of the edges to guarantee a C4. But how much less?
Less than
And well, okay, we haven't even proved that we get little o n squared yet.
Okay. So, let's do theorem. Add this again, this time in
something like 35, so a lot earlier.
We showed that the extremal number of C4 is little o n squared.
In fact, he proved quite a lot more, but you'll see from the proof what we get. But first, let's try and do this. So what's the statement? The statement is if you take a graph with a positive density of edges, so one in every million edges is present, and n is sufficiently large, then you must find a C4 somewhere. This is very different from the cases we've dealt with so far, say triangles, you need half of the edges. Here you only need a tiny proportion. But why? How do you find a C4? So I'm not sure exactly what you mean, but yes, basically yes. Or something similar to that. Yeah. So what we're going to do, we are going to count cherries. Okay. What's a cherry? That's a cherry, right? Okay, how many cherries are there? Can you tell me exactly how many cherries there are in a graph G? In terms of, say, the degrees of the vertices. So obviously not every graph has the same number of cherries, but in terms of the not the number of edges, that's not enough information, but here's the hint. If I tell you the degree of every vertex, then you can tell me how many there are.
The sum of the beginning.
Right. So how should we count them? Let's count them from the top. Right. So first we pick the vertex that's going to be this guy. And then we have to pick two of its neighbors to be the other two. Okay? Yeah, exactly. So it's the sum over all vertices. Okay, the vertex is going to be this guy of the choice of the other two, which is the degree of V, choose two. Okay? Great. Okay, so we want to now approximate this by something to do with the number of edges. So we know the number of edges. What can we say about the sum of the degrees choose two?
It's quite similar to the sum of the square of the degree.
Yeah.
The sum of the degrees is equal to 2 times the of the number of edges.
Right, so yes, you want it something like the number of edges squared. It's not quite. But what inequality can we use? We have something like the sum of the degrees squared. Right? That's it, what you were saying. So the sum of right, you can use Cauchy Schwarz. So I mean, even more generally, this is a convex sequence, right? X squared is convex. So this thing is convex, So you know that this is at least, you know, it's minimized when all of the degrees are the same. Right? So it's at least, so if all of these are the same, then you get n, one for each, times basically the sum of the degrees divided by n, choose 2. So I guess I'm cheating slightly because this doesn't have to be an integer, but this has a continuous, an analytic extension, so let's not worry. So what's the sum of the degrees? It's twice the number of edges. Yeah. So this equals what? So n over 2 times twice the number of edges over n squared. All right? So sum of degrees is same as twice the number of edges. So you have twice the number of edges over n, choose 2, which is basically that squared over 2. So maybe equals is in inverted commas. I could put at least and divide by 3 for one. Okay? So what we have is a pretty good lower bound on the number of cherries. And we know it's basically we have equality when all the degrees are about the same. Okay. Okay. So that's good. So we've counted the number of cherries in one way. But you might have noticed we haven't yet used the fact that our graph has no C4. Okay. So we better use that at some point. So now we're going to count in a second way. A very nice trick, because very often in combinatorics, is counting things in two ways and then comparing. So we have a lower bound, let's get an upper bound. And remember that at some point we have to use that there's no C4. So let's use it now. How many cherries can you have without having a copy of C4? Let me rewrite this. But if it's a tree, it's only going to have about n, and I think we can have more than that. So how do you make a C4 out of a cherry? Or out of more than one cherry?
Two cherries.
Two cherries, which have the same feet. Right? If you have two cherries with the same feet, then you have a C4. So, if you have no C4, for each pair of feet, you only have one cherry. How many possible pairs of feet are there?
The number of buttons.
Hmm? Choose 2. Yeah. Done. So if G is C4 free, since each pair of vertices can be the feet of only one cherry. It's a terrible mixed metaphor. But I didn't really want to say the cherries of only one cherry. So, anyway. Anyway, so we have a lower bound and upper bound, so we're basically done, right? So this implies that this number here, n over 2 times twice the number of edges of G over n squared, is at most n choose 2. Yep. Which implies what? So this is edges of G squared over n squared. We have an n comes up. Edges of G squared is at most what? Basically n cubed. Maybe with a 2 in front, but I think not. Okay. Which implies the edges of G is at most n for 3 over 2. Which is quite a lot better than we wanted. Okay. So we've actually proved is not little o n squared, but big O n to the 3 over 2. So Eddie proved this, but didn't really state it in this language, because he wasn't really interested in extremal graph theory at that point. Extremal graph theory didn't exist. He was interested in a problem about Seedon sets, which are sets which don't have any solutions to A plus B equals C plus D. So it was a problem like the ones we were talking about last week. And he reduced the problem to this one, solved it, deduced this theorem, everyone was very happy, didn't think about it again. Then 20 years later, when extremal graph theory became a big subject, or maybe even longer, 30 years later, he wrote something like he can't believe he was so blind as to not realize that this was a nice question in his own right and had all these generalizations that he could have started this subject, but he missed his chance. But you know, he started 5 or 10 other subjects, so it's probably okay. Anyway, so is the proof okay? So let's do what Erdős didn't do and generalize it in the obvious way. Well, perhaps there are two obvious ways to generalize this. And it turns out that one is quite a lot harder than the other one. Yeah. So tell me two questions you might ask, possible generalizations of this result. Well, tell me one. Sorry? Right, so we did a 4-cycle, why don't do a k-cycle? Well, okay, the odd ones have chromatic number 3, the even cycles are bipartite. Okay, that's the hard one. Did you have a different one? The same one. So perhaps I gave a hint by drawing the picture like this. A 4-cycle you can draw as a 4-cycle, but you can also draw it as 2 cherries with the same feet, which is a complete bipartite graph with 2 vertices on each side. So the easier generalization, which is done by Kovari, Shosh, and Churin. Not till, did I get this right? 50-something? 60-something? I forget. It's like 1960, so quite a lot later. The extremal number of a complete bipartite graph with S vertices in one side and T versus the other side is at most what? Let's see what we get. Okay. So watch this graph. This graph is S vertices one side, T the other side, and all vertices, all edges in between. Okay. Such that C4 equals K22. The complete bipartite graph. And it's a nice graph because, for example, it contains all other bipartite graphs. Or every bipartite graph is contained in a complete bipartite graph. Those are the maximal bipartite graphs. Okay. Okay, well, let's first prove, again, little o n squared, and see what comes out of the proof. So how do you prove it? It's the lesson we learned from earlier. If you have a special case from like Mantell, and you know how to do that, perhaps the first thing you should do is try and generalize the proof. Or certainly any proof that's going to be, any proof of the more general thing is also going to prove the simple thing. So maybe you first collect proofs of the simple thing and see which ones generalize. So we have a proof of the special case. How are you going to generalize it? What are we going to count? Right, S cherries. Well, either S cherries or T cherries, right? Let's count S cherries. We haven't assumed, although my picture assumed, we haven't assumed that S or T is bigger or smaller, so we can count whichever, see what it gives, and just put in whichever numbers we like. Okay, let's count S cherries. What are S cherries? K1s's. Okay. So let's just repeat the proof. Maybe I'll start over. So I can leave that so you can copy it. So number of S cherries equals so it is exactly the same. Sum of the number of vertices of the degree of V, choose S. Okay, so to do the convexity, maybe we should first take a lower bound on this number. We don't care about constants, so this is at least the sum of the vertices of, what is it, d of v to the power s over s factorial. That's a nice lower bound on on D of V choose S. Right? Yeah. Okay. Because it's really D of V times D of V minus 1 times D minus 2 times dot, dot, dot. S times. Okay. So now we can use convexity. So X to the S is convex. And that tells us that this sum is minimized when all of the terms are equal, okay, and all of the degrees are equal. And you get n
well, over s factorial times the sum of the degrees divided by n to the power s.
Okay? So all I did was say, if all the degrees are equal, then they're all equal to this. And so you get this to the s n times.
Okay.
And this is, again, twice the number of edges. So this equals, what do we get? N to the power 1 minus s over s factorial times the number of edges of g to the power s. Sorry, twice the number of edges of g. Okay. 2 to the s over s factorial let's say edges of g to the s over n to the s minus 1. That's a nicer way of writing it.
Okay,
so some constant that we don't care about times edges of g to the s over n to the s minus 1. Okay, good. Second part, S cherries is at most maybe it's slightly trickier. How many S cherries can you have if you don't have an KST? Last time we observed that each pair of vertices can be the feet of only one cherry. So how many S set, how many, sorry?
For each S subset, you can have at most T.
So if you have T, then you'll have a KST. So if you don't have a KST, you have at most T minus 1. Yeah, exactly. So for each S set, you have at most T minus 1 S cherries. So
T minus 1 times N choose S.
Okay. If KST free, since T S cherries with same feet form KST.
Good. So this number is at most that number.
This implies 2 to the S over S factorial, we don't care about, E of G to the S over N to the S minus 1 is at most, this number is basically T minus 1 over S factorial times N to the S.
Okay. So, okay, maybe I cheated slightly here by saying no, I didn't cheat at all. Sorry, I cheated here. This should have been D of V minus S, but it's not going to matter. So apologies. This inequality is not quite true. But okay, if you work it out, then what you get is actually E of G minus S times N instead of E of G. But okay, if the number of edges is much bigger than linear, much bigger than N, which is going to be, then you don't care. So I apologize here that I cheated slightly, but you can check it that it doesn't matter. Okay. I maybe lose a factor of 2. I'll put an S minus 1 here.
Okay, and now you really see that S minus 1 doesn't matter, because what are we wanting to prove? Let's forget all the constants and just say, all right, E of G is big O of, so let's put the S minus 1 up, divide by S, n to the 2 minus 1 over S. Okay. So where the big O, the constant, depends on S and T, but actually it looks like it's at most T, right? So not very big. In fact, T to the 1 over S. Is that okay? So what have we proved? We proved not just little o n squared, we proved big O n to the 2 minus 1 over S. Okay. So we've improved Edish-Stone for bipartite graphs. Edish-Stone told us that we got little o n squared, and we've proved something much stronger, that we're most n to the 2 minus epsilon. In fact, n to the 2 minus 1 over s. Remember that we could have done this for s or t, so this bound makes it clear that the correct thing to do is do it for the smaller one. Right. So if s is at most t, then you should use this bound. Right. Okay. And note this bound matches the bound we got for c4, where s was 2. Okay, so it was a completely straightforward generalization. And yet somehow Edish missed it, and it took 25 years for someone to think to do it. Okay, so there's not very long left. So let me tell you perhaps a little bit about lower bounds for these numbers. So there is no general theory of the extremal number of bipartite graphs. That this is a subject which is very, very well studied and seems to be extremely hard. So I'll give you an idea of that by telling you some open problems. First, a couple of lower bounds. So the question is, how good is this theorem? Is it close to being best possible? And it's been shown that, yes, it's very good. Some small constant times n to the 2 minus 1 over s in various cases. So if s is either 2 or 3, then it's okay. And if t is bigger than s factorial for every s. So if you have a very lopsided complete bipartite graph, then this really is the right thing. But if you have something that's balanced, that the two sides are about the same size, then it seems to be very difficult to construct graphs with no KST, with a lot of edges. So in particular, the following question is open. So it says, I guess it has to be a conjecture, that the extremal number of K 4-4 divided by the extremal number of K3-3. So what should this be? If the conjecture, if the theorem is sharp, it should be, well, this will be 2 minus a third, and this will be 2 minus a quarter. It should be like n to the 12th. It should be pretty big. It's not known if it goes to infinity. the construction for K44 is no better than the construction for K33. The constructions that they use to prove these things, this is a series of three multi-author papers, are pretty complicated and number theoretical and geometric. They use some quite complicated mathematics. So this is a very basic but important open problem. It's a very old open problem. Can you somehow either construct or show they exist graphs with this property, with this number of edges and no K44 even? So it's a complete graph on, it's got 8 vertices and 16 edges. No one can do it. Okay. Another result where the situation is similar is for even cycles. So it was proved in the 70s by Bondi and Simonovitz that the extremal number of C2K is It's not much bigger than n. It's n to the 1 plus 1 over k at most. So if you have a bit more than a linear number of edges, then you can find an even cycle. This one is known to be sharp if k equals 2, 3, or 5, I believe. Strangely enough. So all primes. For k equals 2, then the construction is a projective plane, for those of you who know what anything about projective geometry. And the constructions for C6 and C10 are sort of more complicated geometric objects. That I don't know anything, I must admit I don't know anything about these constructions. I just know that I don't really understand this construction already, and so. There's a very interesting interaction here between these very simple problems about graphs and much more complicated number theory and geometry that no one really understands yet. But there seems to be something sort of quite complicated going on. Let me finish for today by telling you how to prove a slightly worse lower bound than this. So what's a way that we can come up with a graph with no C2K, but quite a lot of edges. So a lot more than n edges, for example. But even that, it's not very easy to construct. But following Erdős's lead, the proof we saw last week, we can show that one exists. So let's prove that this thing is bigger than n to the 1 plus some constant. So for some c of k bigger than 0, let's show this using random methods. This proof is going to, we're going to talk a lot more about the object I'm about to define. So maybe I'll just define it in a very rough way now, and later on we'll talk more about it. So I'm going to define a random graph. But unlike the random coloring that we took last time, where we basically just took all colorings, picked one uniformly, we're going to pick a random graph. If you just look at all of them, most of them have about n squared over four edges. So we want a graph that has very few edges, n to the 1 plus c. So we can't just take a uniform graph. We want to take a uniform one with about this number of edges. And so either you could do exactly that, or here's just a slightly nicer way of doing the same thing. Let's define GMP, which is the so-called Erdős-Rényi random graph, to be the random graph on n vertices where each edge is present independently with probability p. Okay. So for each edge, you toss a bias coin, which comes up heads with probability p. And if it comes up heads, you add the edge. If not, you don't. So you'd expect this graph, and then I let GMP be the graph that results. So you'd expect this graph to have about p times n choose 2 edges. So let's pick p correctly so that we get about this number of edges. What we'd like is that this graph has no cycles, no cycles of length 2k. Okay, well let's count them. Okay. So as before, we wanted to find a coloring with no monochromatic clique. We counted the monochromatic cliques. Here we want to find a graph with no C2k, so let's count the copies of C2k. Okay. So let xk be the number of C2k in GMP. So this is a random variable. For each realization of GMP, it takes some integer, positive integer value. Okay, non-negative integer value. Right. Yeah, so GMP is really, I'll talk more about this in a couple of weeks. It's not really a graph, it's actually a distribution on all graphs. But you can think of it as being a graph. You can think of it as being a realization of the random variable. Okay, so there's a number of C2k. So what's the expected value of xk? Well, how many different copies of C2k are there? Let's say approximately. Well, there's about n to the 2k of them. So you have to choose the vertices in a prescribed order. So that's n times n minus 1 times n minus 2 to n minus 2k. Okay, and then you've chosen each one k times, so divided by k. Let's not worry about constants. K is a constant. So times the probability that that copy of C2k is really present. Right. So each of the edges has to be chosen. There are 2k edges. Each is in independently with probability p. So you get p to the 2k. Okay. Okay. Okay, so if p is roughly, so what do we want p to be? If P times n squared is roughly n to the 1 plus c, then P is roughly n to the minus 1 plus c. So this thing will be roughly n to the c times k. Okay, so that's bad, right? What we were hoping was that if we take a random graph, it'll have a lot of edges and no copies of c2k at all. And that's not true. There are lots. There are n to the c times k. So what can we do? Right. We can, if we don't have too many, maybe we can just take them out. Or even better, destroy them. That if you only have, suppose you had, this was less than n. That is, if c is less than 1 over k. Less than or equal to. I feel like I'm proving something too strong. Anyway, we'll see. So c is less than 1 over k, so you only have about n copies. Then from each one, you can pick an edge, throw it out. Okay. So take your GMP, look at all your copies of c2k. There's only about n of them. From each one, pick an edge and throw it out. You still have basically the same number of edges. Right? You have n to the 1 plus c minus n. Nothing. So you found a graph with this many edges and with no c2k. So remove one edge from each copy of C2K, get graph with n to the 1 plus c edges C2K free. So now I'm a little confused and I feel like I may have stated this wrong, but I don't think so. So, something is wrong here, because this result is too strong. But anyway, so in the book there will be the correct statement, I think, somewhere. For those who have it. I seem to have stated that. Aha! I see the mistake. Good. It was here. This isn't n to the ck, it's n to the 2ck. Right? So this is pn to the 2k. Okay, good. So, c has to be less than 1 over 2k. Right. So what we found is, what we've proved is the lower bound of n to the 1 plus 1 over 2k. So a little worse than what's conjectured to be true. But again, how do we do it? We took a graph completely at random with the right number of edges. So of all graphs with the right number of edges, we just chose one. And then we said, okay, this isn't the one we want, but if we do a little bit of surgery, if we just change it slightly, we can find the graph we want. It's another example when thinking randomly can... So I think doing something random plus something deterministic can give you what you want. Anyway, we'll talk a lot more about it next time. Questions? Okay, so I won't see you on Monday, but Simon will.